Story number one of three science fiction stories by William Tenn. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Phil Chenevert, Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Story number one, Venus is a Man's World. This story was first published in Galaxy Science Fiction, July 1951. Venus is a Man's World by William Tenn. I've always said that even if Sis is 7 years older than me, and a girl besides, she don't always know what's best. Put me on a spaceship jam-packed with 300 females just aching to get themselves husbands in the one place they're still to be had, the planet Venus, and you know I'll be in trouble. Bad trouble, with the law, which is the worst a boy can get into. 20 minutes after we lifted from the Sahara spaceport, I wriggled out of my acceleration hammock and started for the door of our cabin. "Now you be careful, Ferdinand," Sis called after me as she opened a book called Family Problems of the Frontier Woman. "Remember, you're a nice boy. Don't make me ashamed of you." I tore down the corridor. Most of the cabins had purple lights on in front of the doors, showing that the girls were still inside their hammocks. That meant only the ship's crew was up and about. Ship's crews are men. Women are too busy with important things like government to run ships. I felt free all over and happy. Now was my chance to really see the Eleanor Roosevelt. It was hard to believe I was traveling in space at last. Ahead and behind me, all the way up to where the companionway curved in out of sight, there was nothing but smooth black wall and smooth white doors. And on and on and on. Gee, I thought excitedly, this is one big ship. Of course, every once in a while I would run across a big scene of stars in the void set in the wall, but they were only pictures. Nothing that gave the feel of great empty space like I'd read about in The Boy Rocketeers. No portholes, no visiplates, nothing. So when I came to the crossway, I stopped for a second, then turned left. To the right, see, there was deck four, then deck three, leading inward past the engine focussle to the main jets and the grav helix going purr, purr, purty purr in the comforting way big machinery has when it's happy and oiled. But to the left, the crossway led all the way to the outside level, which ran just under the hull. There were portholes in the hull. I'd studied all that out in our cabin long before we lifted on the transparent model of the ship hanging like a big cigar from the ceiling. Sis had studied it, too, but she was looking for places like the dining salon and the library and Lifeboat 68, where we should go in case of emergency. I looked for the important things. As I trotted along the crossway, I sort of wished that Sis hadn't decided to go after a husband on a luxury liner. On a cargo ship now, I'd be climbing from deck to deck on a ladder instead of having gravity underfoot all the time, just like I was home on the bottom of the Gulf of Mexico. But women always know what's right, and a boy can only make faces and do what they say, same as the men have to. Still, it was pretty exciting to press my nose against the slots in the wall and see the sliding panels that would come charging out and block the crossways into an airtight fit in case a meteor or something smashed into the ship. And all along there were glass cases with spacesuits standing in them, like those knights they used to have back in the Middle Ages. "In the event of disaster affecting the oxygen content of companionway," they had the words etched into the door, "break glass with hammer upon wall, remove spacesuit, and proceed to don it in the following fashion." I read the following fashion until I knew it by heart. "Boy," I said to myself, "I hope we have that kind of disaster. I'd sure like to get into one of those. Bet it would be more fun than those diving suits back in undersea." And all the time I was alone. That was the best part. Then I passed deck 12, and there was a big sign, "Notice, passengers not permitted past this point." A big sign, in red. I peeked around the corner. I knew it. The next deck was the hull. I could see the portholes. Every 12 feet they were, filled with the velvet of space and the dancing of more stars than I'd ever dreamed existed in the universe. There wasn't anyone on the deck, as far as I could see, and this distance from the grav helix the ship seemed mighty quiet and lonely if I just took one quick look. But I thought of what Sis would say, and I turned around obediently. Then I saw the big red sign again. Passengers not permitted. Well, didn't I know from my civics class that only women could be Earth citizens these days? Sure, ever since the Male Suffrage Act. And didn't I know that you had to be a citizen of a planet in order to get an interplanetary passport? Sis had explained it all to me in the careful, patient way she always talks politics and things like that to men. Technically, Ferdinand, I'm the only passenger in our family. You can't be one because, not being a citizen, you can't acquire an Earth passport. However, you'll be going to Venus on the strength of this clause. Miss Evelyn Sparling and all dependent male members of family. This number not to exceed the registered quota of sub-regulations pertaining, and so on. I want you to understand these matters, so that you will grow into a man who takes an active interest in world affairs. No matter what you hear, women really like and appreciate such men. Of course, I never pay much attention to Sis when she says such dumb things. I'm old enough, I guess, to know that it isn't what women like and appreciate that counts when it comes to people getting married. If it were, Sis and 300 other pretty girls like her wouldn't be on their way to Venus to hook husbands. Still, if I wasn't a passenger, the sign didn't have anything to do with me. I know what Sis would say to that, but at least it was an argument I could use if it ever came up. So I broke the law. I was glad I did. The stars were exciting enough, but away off to the left, about 5 times as big as I'd ever seen it, except in the movies, was the moon, a great blob of gray and white pockmarks holding off the black of space. I was hoping to see the Earth, but I figured it must be on the other side of the ship, or behind us. I pressed my nose against the port and saw the tiny flicker of a spaceship taking off Mars-bound. I wish I was on that one. Then I noticed a little farther down the companionway a stretch of blank wall where there should have been portholes. High up on the wall in glowing red letters were the words, "Lifeboat 47, passengers 32, crew 11. Unauthorized personnel, keep away." Another one of those signs. I crept up to the porthole nearest it and could just barely make out the stern jets where it was plastered against the hull. Then I walked under the sign and tried to figure the way you were supposed to get into it. There was a very thin line going around in a big circle that I knew must be the door, but I couldn't see any knobs or switches to open it with, not even a button you could press. That meant it was a sonic lock like the kind we had on the outer keeps back home in undersea. But knock or voice? I tried the two knock combinations I knew and nothing happened. I only remembered one voice key. Might as well see if that's it, I figured. 2023, open sesame. For a second, I thought I'd hit it just right out of all the million possible combinations. The door clicked inward toward a black hole, and a hairy hand as broad as my shoulders shot out of the hole. It closed around my throat and plucked me inside as if I'd been a baby sardine. I bounced once on the hard lifeboat floor. Before I got my breath and sat up, the door had been shut again. When the light came on, I found myself staring up the muzzle of a highly polished blaster and into the cold blue eyes of the biggest man I'd ever seen. He was wearing a one-piece suit made of some scaly green stuff that looked hard and soft at the same time. His boots were made of it, too, and so was the hood hanging down his back. And his face was brown. Not just ordinary tan, you understand, but the deep dark burned all the way in brown I'd seen on the lifeguards in New Orleans whenever we took a surface vacation. The kind of tan that comes from day after broiling day under a really hot sun. His hair looked as if it had once been blonde, but now there were just long combed out waves with a yellowish tinge that boiled all the way down to his shoulders. I hadn't seen hair like that on a man except maybe in history books. Every man I'd ever known had his hair cropped in the fashionable soup bowl style. I was staring at his hair, almost forgetting about the blaster, which I knew it was against the law for him to have at all, when I suddenly got scared right through. His eyes. They didn't blink, and there seemed to be no expression around them, just coldness. Maybe it was the kind of clothes he was wearing that did it, but all of a sudden I was reminded of a crocodile I'd seen in a surface zoo that had stared quietly at me for 20 minutes until it opened two long, tooth-studded jaws. "Rain shatters," he said suddenly. "Only a tadpole. I must be getting jumpy enough to splash." Then he shoved the blaster away in a holster made of the same scaly leather, crossed his arms on his chest, and began to study me. I grunted to my feet, feeling a lot better. The coldness had gone out of his eyes. I held out my hand the way Sis had taught me. "My name is Ferdinand Sparling. I'm very pleased to meet you, Mr.
"Hope for your sake," he said to me, "that you aren't what you seem, tadpole brother to one of them husbandless Anora."
"What?"
"A Noran is a female looking to nest. Anora is a herd of the same. Come from Flatfolk ways."
"Flatfolk are the Venusian natives, aren't they? Are you a Venusian? What part of Venus do you come from? Why did you say you hope—"
He chuckled and swung me into one of the bunks that lined the lifeboat. "Questions you ask," he said in a soft voice. "Venus is a sharp enough place for a dry horn, let alone a tadpole dry horn with a boss-minded sister."
"I'm not a dry leg," I told him proudly. "We're from undersea."
"Dry horn," I said, "not dry leg. And what's undersea?"
"Well, in undersea we call foreigners and newcomers dry legs. Just like on Venus, I guess, you call them dry horns."
And then I told him how undersea had been built on the bottom of the Gulf of Mexico when the mineral resources of the land began to give out, and engineers figured that a lot could still be reached from the sea bottoms.
He nodded. He'd heard about the sea-bottom mining cities that were bubbling under protective domes in every one of the Earth's oceans just about the same time settlements were springing up on the planets. He looked impressed when I told him about Mom and Pop being one of the first couples to get married in undersea. He looked thoughtful when I told him how Sis and I had been born there and spent half our childhood listening to the pressure pumps. He raised his eyebrows and looked disgusted when I told him how Mom, an undersea representative on the World Council, had been one of the framers of the Male Desuffrage Act after the Third Atomic War had resulted in the Maternal Revolution. He almost squeezed my arm when I got to the time Mom and Pop were blown up in a surfacing boat. "Well, after the funeral there was a little money, so Sis decided we might as well use it to migrate. There was no future for her on Earth, she figured. You know, the 3 out of 4.
"How's that?"
"The 3 out of 4. No more than 3 women out of every 4 on Earth can expect to find husbands. Not enough men to go around. Way back in the 20th century it began to be felt, Sis says, what with the wars and all. Then the wars went on and a lot more men began to die or get no good from the radioactivity. Then the best men went to the planets, Sis says, until by now, even if a woman can scrounge a personal husband, he's not much to boast about." The stranger nodded violently.
"Not on Earth, he isn't.
Those busybody Honora make sure of that. What a place! Suffering gridniks, I had a bellyful.
He told me about it. Women were scarce on Venus, and he hadn't been able to find any who were willing to come out to his lonely little islands. He had decided to go to Earth, where there was supposed to be a surplus. Naturally, having been born and brought up on a very primitive planet, he didn't know it's a woman's world, like the older boys in school used to say. The moment he landed on Earth, he was in trouble. He didn't know he had to register at a government-operated hotel for transient males. He threw a bartender through a thick plastic window for saying something nasty about the length of his hair, and imagine he not only resisted arrest, resulting in 3 hospitalized policemen, but he sassed the judge in open court. Told me a man wasn't supposed to say anything except through female attorneys. Told her that where I come from, a man spoke his piece when he'd a mind to, and his woman walked by his side. What happened? I asked breathlessly. Oh, guilty of this and contempt of that. That blown-up brinosaur took my last munit for fines and then explained that she was remitting the rest because I was a foreigner and uneducated. His eyes grew dark for a moment. He chuckled again. But I wasn't going to serve all those fancy little prison sentences. Forcible citizenship indoctrination, they call it. Shook the dead, dry dust of the misbegotten, godforsaken mother world from my feet forever. The women on it deserve their men. My pockets were folded from the fines, and the paddle feet were looking for me so close I didn't dare radio for more munit. So I stowed away. For a moment I didn't understand him. When I did, I was almost ill.
You mean, I choked, that you're breaking the law right now? And I'm with you while you're doing it?
He leaned over the edge of the bunk and stared at me very seriously. What breed of tadpole are they turning out these days? Besides, what business do you have this close to the hull? After a moment of sober reflection, I nodded.
You're right. I've become almost a male outside the law. We're in this together.
He guffawed. Then he sat up and began cleaning his blaster. I found myself drawn to the bright killer tube with exactly the fascination Sist insists such things have always had for men. Ferdinand, your label? That's not right for a sprouting tadpole. I'll call you Ford. My name's Butt. Butt Lee Brown. I like the sound of Ford.
Is Butt a nickname, too?
Yeah, short for Alberta, but I haven't found a man who can draw a blaster fast enough to call me that. You see, Pop came over in the 80s, the big wave of immigrants when they evacuated Ontario. Named all us boys after Canadian provinces. I was the youngest, so I got the name they were saving for a girl.
You had a lot of brothers, Mr. Butt?
He grinned with a mighty set of teeth. Oh, a nestful. Of course, they were all killed in the Blue Chicago Rising by the McGregor boys, all except me and Saskatchewan. Then Sass and me hunted the McGregors down. It took a heap of time. We didn't float Jock McGregor's ugly face down the Tuscany till both of us were pretty near grown up. I walked up close to where I could see the tiny, bright copper coils of the blaster above the firing button.
Have you killed a lot of men with that, Mr. Butt?
Butt. Just plain Butt to you, Ford. He frowned and sighted at the light globe. No more than 12, not counting 5 government paddle feet, of course. I'm a peaceable planter. Way I figure it, violence never accomplishes much that's important. My brother Sass now. He had just begun to work into a wonderful anecdote about his brother when the dinner gong rang. But told me to scat. He said I was a growing tadpole and needed my vitamins. And he mentioned, very offhand, that he wouldn't at all object if I brought him some fresh fruit. It seemed there was nothing but processed foods in the lifeboat, and Butt was used to a farmer's diet. Trouble was, he was a special kind of farmer. Ordinary fruit would have been pretty easy to sneak into my pockets at meals. I even found a way to handle the kelp and giant watercress Mr. Brown liked. But things like seaweed salt and Venusian mud grapes just had too strong a smell. Twice the mechanical hamper refused to accept my jacket for laundering, and I had to wash it myself. But I learned so many wonderful things about Venus every time I visited that stowaway. I learned 3 wild wave songs of the flat folk, and what it is that the native Venusians hate so much. I learned how to tell the difference between a lousy government paddlefoot from New Kalamazoo and the slap-toe slinker who is the planter's friend. After a lot of begging, Butley Brown explained the workings of his blaster. He explained it so carefully that I could name every part and told what it did from the tiny round electrodes to the long spirals of transformer. But no matter what, he would never let me hold it. "Sorry for it, old Ted," he would drawl, spinning around and around in the control swivel chair with the nose of the lifeboat. "But way I look at it, a man who lets somebody else handle his blaster is like a giant whose heart was in an egg that an enemy found. When you've grown enough so's your pop feels you ought to have a weapon, why, then's the time to learn it, and you might as well learn fast. Before then, you're plain too young to be even near it." "I don't have a father to give me one when I come of age. I don't even have an older brother as head of my family like your brother Labrador. All I have is Sis, and she'll marry some fancy dryhorn who'd never been further south than the polar coast. And she'll stay head of the family if I know her breed of green shotta. Bossy, opinionated. By the way, Forty," he said, rising and stretching, so the fish leather bounced and rippled off his biceps, "that's Sister. She ever—" And he'd be off again, cross-examining me about Evelyn. I sat in the swivel chair he'd vacated and tried to answer his questions. But there was a lot of stuff I didn't know. Evelyn was a healthy girl, for instance. How healthy exactly, I had no way of finding out. Yes, I'd tell him my aunts on both sides of my family each had had more than the average number of children. No, we'd never done any farming to speak of back in Undersea, but yes, I guess Evelyn knew about as much as any girl there when it came to diving equipment and pressure pump regulation. How would I know that stuff would lead to trouble for me? Sis had insisted I come along to the geography lecture. Most of the other girls who were going to Venus for husbands talked to each other during the lecture, but not my sister. She hung on every word, took notes even, and asked enough questions to make the perspiring purser really work in those orientation periods. "I am very sorry, Miss Sparling," he said with pretty heavy sarcasm, "but I cannot remember any of the agricultural products of the Marco continent. Since the human population is well below 1 per 1,000 square miles, it can readily be understood that the quantity of till soil, land, or subsurface is so small that—" "Wait, I remember something. The macro continent exports a fruit, though not exactly an edible one, the while dunging drug is harvested there by criminal speculators. Contrary to belief on Earth, the traffic has been growing in recent years. In fact—" "Pardon me, sir," I broke in, "but doesn't dunging come only from Leif Erikson Island off the Moscow Peninsula of the Macro Continent? You remember, purser, Wang Li's third exploration, where he proved the island and the peninsula didn't meet for most of the year?" The purser nodded slowly. "I forgot," he admitted. "Sorry, ladies, but the boy's right. Please make the correction in your notes." But Sis was the only one who took notes, and she didn't take that one. She stared at me for a moment, biting her lower lip thoughtfully, while I got sicker and sicker. Then she shut her pad with the final gesture of the right hand that Mom used to use just before challenging the opposition to come right down on the council floor and debate it out with her. "Ferdinand," Sis said, "let's go back to our cabin." The moment she sat me down and walked slowly around me, I knew I was in for it. "I've been reading up on Venusian history in the ship's library," I told her in a hurry. "No doubt," she said dryly. She shook her night-black hair out. "But you aren't going to tell me that you read about dunging in the ship's library. The books there have been censored by a government agent of Earth against the possibility that they might be read by susceptible young male minds like yours. She would not have allowed this Terran agent, Paddlefoot," I sneered. Sis sat down hard in our Zoom Air chair. "Now that's a term," she said carefully, "that is used only by Venusian riffraff." "They're not." "Not what?" "Riffraff," I had to answer, knowing I was getting in deeper all the time and not being able to help it. "I mustn't give Mr. Brown away. They're trappers and farmers, pioneers and explorers who are building Venus. And it takes a real man to build on a hot, hungry hell like Venus." "Does it now?" she said, looking at me as if I were beginning to grow a second pair of ears. "Tell me more." "You can't have meek, law-abiding, women-ruled men when you start civilization on a new planet. You've got to have men who aren't afraid to make their own law if necessary, with their own guns. That's where law begins. The books get written up later." "You're going to tell, Ferdinand, what evil criminal male is speaking through your mouth." "Nobody," I insisted. "They're my own ideas." "They are remarkably well organized for a young boy's ideas. A boy who, I might add, has previously shown a ridiculous but nonetheless entirely masculine boredom with political philosophy. I plan to have a government career on that new planet you talk about, Ferdinand, after I have found a good steady husband, of course, and I don't look forward to a masculinist radical in the family. Now, who has been filling your head with all this nonsense?" I was sweating. Sis has that deadly bulldog approach when she feels someone is lying. I pulled my pulpest handkerchief from my pocket to wipe my face. Something rattled to the floor. "What is that picture of me doing in your pocket, Ferdinand?" A trap seemed to be hinging noisily into place. "One of the passengers wanted to see how you looked in a bathing suit. The passengers on this ship are all female. I can't imagine any of them that curious about my appearance. Ferdinand, it's a man who has been giving you these antisocial ideas, isn't it? A warmongering masculinist like all the frustrated men who want to engage in government and don't have the vaguest idea how to. Except, of course, in their ancient bloody ways. Ferdinand, who has been perverting that sunny and carefree soul of yours?"
"Nobody, nobody."
"Ferdinand, there's no point in lying. I demand—"
"I told you, sis, I told you. And don't call me Ferdinand, call me Ford."
"Ford? Now you listen to me, Ferdinand." After that, it was all over but the confession. That came in a few moments. I couldn't fool Sis. She just knew me too well, I decided miserably. Besides, she was a girl. All the same, I wouldn't get Mr. Butt Lee Brown into trouble if I could help it. I made Sis promise she wouldn't turn him in if I took her to him. And the quick, nodding way she said she would made me feel just a little better. The door opened on the signal, Sesame. When Butt saw somebody was with me, he jumped and the 10-inch blaster barrel grew out of his fingers. Then he recognized Sis from the pictures. He stepped to one side and, with the same sweeping gesture, holstered his blaster and pushed his green hood off. It was Sis's turn to jump when she saw the wild mass of hair rolling down his back. "An honor, Miss Sparling," he said in that rumbly voice. "Please come right in. There's a hurry-up draft." So Sis went in, and I followed right after her. Mr. Brown closed the door. I tried to catch his eye so I could give him some kind of hint or explanation, but he had taken a couple of his big strides and was in the control section with Sis. She didn't give ground, though. I'll say that for her. She only came to his chest, but she had her arms crossed sternly. "First, Mr. Brown," she began, like talking to a cluck of a kid in class, "you realize that you are not only committing the political crime of traveling without a visa, and the criminal one of stowing away without paying your fare, but the moral delinquency of consuming stores intended for the personnel of this ship solely in emergency." He opened his mouth to its maximum width and raised an enormous hand. Then he let the air out and dropped his arm. "I take it you either have no defense or care to make none," Sis added caustically, but laughed slowly and carefully, as if he were going over each word.
"Wonder if all the Onora talk like that.
And you want to foul up Venus. We haven't done so badly on Earth after the mess you men made of politics. It needed a revolution of the mothers before—"
"Needed nothing. Everybody wanted peace. Earth is a weary old world."
"It's a world of strong moral fiber compared to yours, Mr. Alberta Lee Brown." Hearing his rightful name made him move suddenly and tower over her. Sis said with a certain amount of hurry and change of tone, "What do you have to say about storing away and using up lifeboat stores?"
He cocked his head and considered a moment. "Look," he said finally, "I have more than enough munit to pay for round-trip tickets, but I couldn't get a return visa because of that brontosaur judge and all the charges she hung on me. Had to stow away. Picked the Eleanor Roosevelt because a couple of the boys in the crew were friends of mine, and they were willing to help. But this lifeboat, don't you know that every passenger ship carries 4 times as many lifeboats as it needs? Not to mention the food I didn't eat because it stuck in my throat."
"Yes," she said bitterly, "you had this boy steal fresh fruit for you. I suppose you didn't know that under space regulations that makes him equally guilty?"
"No, sis, he didn't," I was beginning to argue. "All he wanted—"
"Sure, I knew. And I knew that if I'm picked up as a stowaway, I'll be sent back to Earth to serve out those fancy little sentences."
"Well, you're guilty of them, aren't you?"
He waved his hands at her impatiently. "I'm not talking law, female. I'm talking sense. Listen, I'm in trouble because I went to Earth to look for a wife. You're standing here right now because you're on your way to Venus for a husband. So, let's."
Sis actually staggered back.
"Let's? Let's what? Are you daring to suggest that—"
"Now, Miss Sparling, no hoopla. I'm saying let's get married, and you know it. You figured out from what the boy told you that I was chewing on you for a wife. You're healthy and strong, got good heredity. You know how to operate subsurface machinery, you've lived underwater, and your disposition's no worse than most of the Onora I've seen. Prolific stock, too."
I was so excited I just had to yell, "Jesus, say yes!"
My sister's voice was steaming with scorn.
"And what makes you think that I'd consider you a desirable husband?"
He spread his hands genially. "Figure if you wanted a poodle, you're pretty enough to pick one up on Earth. Figure if you charge off to Venus, you don't want a poodle, you want a man. I'm one. I own 3 islands in the Gallatin Archipelago. That'll be good oozing mud grape land when they're cleared. Not to mention the rich Braziliad beds offshore. I got no bad habits, outside of having my own way. I'm also passable good-looking for a slap-toe planter. Besides, if you marry me, you'll be the first mated on this ship, and that's a splash most nesting females like to make." There was a longest stretch of quiet. Sis stepped back and measured him slowly with her eyes. There was a lot to look at. He waited patiently while she covered the distance from his peculiar green boots to that head of hair.
I was so excited. I was gulping instead of breathing. Imagine having Butt for a brother-in-law and living on a wet plantation in flatboat country. But then I remembered Sis's level head, and I didn't have much hope anymore. "You know," she began, "there's more to marriage than just..."
"So there is," he cut in. "Well, we can try each other for taste."
And he pulled her in, both of his great hands practically covering her slim straight back. Neither of them said anything for a bit after he let go, but spoke up first.
"Now me," he said, "I'd vote yes."
Sis ran the tip of her tongue kind of delicately from side to side of her mouth. Then she stepped back slowly and looked at him as if she were figuring out how many feet high he was. She kept on moving backward, tapping her chin, while Butt and I got more impatient. When she touched the lifeboat door, she pushed it open and jumped out. Butt ran over and looked down the crossway. After a while, he shut the door and came back beside me. "Well," he said, swinging to a bunk, "that's sort of it."
"You're better off, Butt," I burst out. "You shouldn't have a woman like Sis for a wife. She looks small and helpless, but don't forget she was trained to run an underwater city."
"Wasn't worried about that," he grinned. "I grew up in the 15 long years of the Blue Chicago Rising."
"Nope."
He turned over on his back and clicked his teeth at the ceiling. "Think we'd have nested out nicely." I hitched myself up to him and we sat on the bunk, glooming away at each other. Then we heard the tramp of feet in the crossway. Butt swung down and headed for the control compartment in the nose of the lifeboat. He had his blaster out and was cursing very interestingly. I started after him, but he picked me up by the seat of my jumper and tossed me toward the door. The captain came in and tripped over me. I got all tangled up in his gold braid and million-mile space buttons. When we finally got to our feet and started out right, he was breathing very hard. The captain was a round little man with a plump golden face and a very scared look on it. He humped at me, just the way Sis does, and lifted me by the scruff of my neck. The chief mate picked me up and passed me to the second assistant engineer. Sis was there, being held by the purser on one side and the chief computer's mate on the other. Behind them, I could see a flock of wide-eyed female passengers.
"You cowards!" Sis was raging. "Letting your captain face a dangerous outlaw all by himself."
"I don't know, Miss Sparling," the computer's mate said, scratching the miniature Sly Rule insignia on his visor with his free hand. "The old man would have been willing to let it go with a log entry, figuring the spaceport paddle feet could pry out the stowaway when we landed. But you had to quote the Mother Anita law at him, and he's in there doing his duty. He figures the rest of us are family men, too, and there's no sense making orphans."
"You promised, Sis," I told her through my teeth. "You promised you wouldn't get Butt into trouble."
She tossed her spiral curls at me and ground a heel into the purser's instep. He screwed up his face and scowled, but he didn't let go of her arm.
"Shush, Ferdinand. This is serious."
"It was," I heard the captain say. "I'm not carrying a weapon, Brown."
"Then get one," Butt's low, lazy voice floated out.
"No, thanks. You're as handy with that thing as I am with the rocket board." The captain's words got a little fainter as he walked forward. Butt growled like a gusher about to blow.
"I'm counting on your being a good guy, Brown." The captain's voice quavered just a bit. "I'm banking on what I heard about the Blast Happy Browns every time I lifted gravs in New Kalamazoo. They have a code. They don't burn unarmed men."
Just about this time, events in the lifeboat went down to a mumble. The top of my head got wet, and I looked up. There was sweat rolling down the second assistant's forehead. It converged at his nose and bounced off the tip in a sizable stream. I twisted out of the way.
"What's happening?" Sis gritted, straining toward the lock.
"Butt's trying to decide whether he wants him fried or scrambled," the computer's mate said, pulling her back. "Hey, Purse, remember when the whole family with their pop at the head went into heat wave to argue with Colonel Leclerc?"
11 dead, 64 injured," the purser answered mechanically. and no more army stations south of Icebox. His right ear twitched irritably.
But what are they saying?
Suddenly we heard.
By authority vested in me under the Pomona College Treaty, the captain was saying very loudly, I arrest you for violation of Articles 16 to 21 inclusive of the Space Transport Code and order your person and belongings impounded for the duration of this voyage as set forth in Sections 41 and 45.
43 and 45, Sis groaned. Sections 43 and 45, I told him. I even made him repeat it after me.
Of the Mother Anita Law, SC-2136, Emergency Interplanetary Directives.
We all waited breathlessly for Butt's reply. The seconds ambled on, and there was no clatter of electrostatic discharge, no smell of burning flesh. Then we heard some feet walking. A big man in a green suit swung out into the crossway. That was Butt. Behind him came the captain, holding the blaster gingerly with both hands. Butt had a funny, thoughtful look on his face. The girls surged forward when they saw him, scattering the crew to one side. They were like a school of sharks that had just caught sight of a dying whale.
Are all Venusians built like that? Men like that are worth the mileage. I want him. I want him. I want him.
Sis had to let go. She grabbed my free hand and pulled me away. She was trying to look only annoyed, but her eyes had bright little bubbles of fury popping in them.
The cheap extroverts, and they call themselves responsible women.
I was angry, too, and I let her know once we were in our cabin.
What about that promise, Sis? You said you wouldn't turn him in. You promised.
She stopped walking around the room as if she had been expecting to get to Venus on foot.
I know I did, Ferdinand, but he forced me.
My name is Ford, and I don't understand.
Your name is Ferdinand, and stop trying to act forcefully like a girl. It doesn't become you. In just a few days, you'll forget all this and be your simple, carefree self again.
I really, truly meant to keep my word.
From what you'd told me, Mr. Brown seemed to be a fundamentally decent chap, despite his barbaric notions on equality between the sexes, or worse. I was positive I could shame him into a more rational social behavior and make him give himself up. Then
She pressed her fingernails into her palms and let out a long, glaring sigh at the door. Then he kissed me. Oh, it was a good enough kiss. Mr. Brown has evidently had a varied and colorful background. But the galling idiocy of the man trying that.
I was just getting over the colossal impudence involved in his proposing marriage, as if he had to bear the children, and was considering the offer seriously on its merits, as one should consider all suggestions, when he deliberately dropped the pretense of reason. He appealed to me as most of the savage ancients appeal to their women, as an emotional machine. Throw the correct sexual switches, says this theory, and the female surrenders herself ecstatically to the doubtful and bloody murk of masculine plans.
There was a double knock on the door, and the captain walked in without waiting for an invitation. He was still holding Butt's blaster.
He pointed it at me.
"Get your hands up, Ferdinand Sparling," he said.
I did.
"I hereby order your detention for the duration of this voyage for aiding and abetting a stowaway as set forth in Sections 41 and 45.
43 and 45, Sis interrupted him, her eyes getting larger and rounder.
"But you gave me your word of honor that no charges would be lodged against the boy."
41 and 45, he corrected her courteously, still staring fiercely at me. I looked it up. Of the Anita Mason Law, Emergency Interplanetary Directives. That was the usual promise one makes to an informer, but that was before I knew it was Butt Lee Brown you were talking about. I didn't want to arrest Butt Lee Brown. You forced me, so I'm breaking my promise to you just as, I understand, you broke your promise to your brother. They'll both be picked up at the new Kalamazoo spaceport and sent Terranward for trial."
"But I used all of our money to buy passage," Sis wailed.
"And now you'll have to return with the boy. I'm sorry, Miss Sparling, but as you explained to me, a man who has been honored with an important official position should stay close to the letter of the law for the sake of other men who are trying to break down terrestrial anti-male prejudice. Of course, there's a way out."
"There is? Tell me, please."
"Can I lower my hands a minute?" I asked. "No, you can't, son. Not according to the armed surveillance provisions of the Mother Anita law. Miss Sparling, if you'd marry Brown..."
Now, don't look at me like that. We could let the whole matter drop.
A shipboard wedding, and he goes on your passport as a dependent male member of family, which means, so far as the law is concerned, that he has a regulation passport from the beginning of this voyage. And once we touch Venusian soil, he can contact his bank and pay for passage. On the record, no crime was ever committed. He's free, the boy's free, and you
are married to an uncombed desperado who doesn't know enough to sit back and let a woman run things? Oh, you should be ashamed."
The captain shrugged and spread his arms wide. "Perhaps I should be, but that's what comes of putting men into responsible positions, as you say. See here, Miss Sparling, I didn't want to arrest Brown, and if it's at all possible, I'd still prefer not to. The crew, officers, and men all go along with me. We may be legal residents of Earth, but our work requires us to be on Venus several times a year. We don't want to be disliked by any member of the highly irritable Brown clan or its collateral branches. But Lee Brown himself, for all of his savage appearance in your civilized eyes, is a man of much influence on the polar continent. In his own bailiwick, the Gallertan Archipelago, he makes, breaks, and occasionally readjusts officials. Then there's his brother Saskatchewan, who considers but a helpless put-upon youngster."
"Much influence, you say, Mr. Brown has?" Sis was suddenly thoughtful.
"Power, actually. The kind a strong man usually wields in a newly settled community. Besides, Miss Sparling, you're going to Venus for a husband because the male-female ratio on Earth is reversed. Well, not only is But Lee Brown a first-class catch, but you can't afford to be too particular in any case. While you're fairly pretty, you won't bring any wealth into a marriage, and your high degree of opinionation is not likely to be well received on a backward masculinist world. Then, too, the woman hunger is not so great anymore, what with the Marie Curie and the Fatima having already deposited their cargoes, the Mademoiselle Sun Yat-sen due to arrive next month." Sis nodded to herself, waved the door open, and walked out.
"Let's hope," the captain said. "Like any father used to say, a man who knows how to handle women, how to get around them without their knowing it, doesn't need to know anything else in his life. I'm plain wasted in space. You can lower your hands now, son."
We sat down, and I explained the blaster to him. He was very interested. He said all But had told him in the lifeboat when they decided to use my arrest as a club over Sis was to keep the safety catch all the way up against his thumb. I could see he really had been excited about carrying a lethal weapon around. He told me that back in the old days, sea captains, actually had the right to keep guns in their cabins all the time to put down mutinies and other things our ancestors did.
The telewall flickered, and we turned it on. Sis smiled down.
"Everything's all right, Captain. Come up and marry us, please."
"What did you stick him for?" he asked. "What was the price?"
Sis's full lips went thin and hard the way Mom's used to. Then she thought better of it and laughed. "Mr. Brown is going to see that I'm elected sheriff of the Gallertan Archipelago."
"And I thought she'd settle for a country clerkship," the captain muttered as we spun up to the brig.
The doors were open, and girls were chattering in every corner. Sis came up to the captain to discuss arrangements. I slipped away and found Butt sitting with folded arms in a corner of the brig. He grinned at me.
"Hi, Tadpole. Like the splash?"
I shook my head unhappily.
"But why did you do it? I'd sure love to be your brother-in-law, but gosh, you don't have to marry, Sis."
I pointed to some of the bustling females. Sis was going to have 300 bridesmaids. Any one of them would have jumped at the chance to be your wife. And once on any woman's passport, you'd be free. Why, Sis?
That's what the captain said in the lifeboat. Told him the same thing I'm telling you. I'm stubborn. What I like at first, I keep on liking. What I want at first, I keep on wanting until I get.
But making Sis sheriff, and you'll have to back her up with your blaster. What'll happen to that man's world?
Wait till after we nest and get out to my islands. He produced a hard-lipped, smug grin, sighting it at Sis's slender back. She'll find herself sheriff over a bunch of natives and exactly 2 Earth males, you and me. I've got a hunch that'll keep her pretty busy, though.
End of Venus is a Man's World by William Tenn.
Project Hush. Story 2 of 3 science fiction stories by William Tenn. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. This story was published in Galaxy Science Fiction, February 1954. Project Hush by William Tenn. I guess I'm just a stickler, a perfectionist. But if you do a thing, I always say you might as well do it right. Everything satisfied me about the security measures on our assignment except one, the official Army designation. Project Hush. I don't know who thought it up, and I certainly would never ask, but whoever it was, he should have known better. Damn it, when you want a project kept secret, you don't give it a designation like that. You give it something neutral, some name like the Manhattan, an Overlord, they used in World War II, which won't excite anybody's curiosity. But we were stuck with Project Hush, and we had to take extra measures to ensure secrecy. A couple of times a week, everyone on the project had to report to Psycho for DD and HA, dream detailing and hypoanalysis, instead of the usual monthly visit. Naturally, the commanding general of the heavily fortified research post to which we were attached could not ask what we were doing, under penalty of court-martial, but he had to be given further instructions to shut off his imagination like a faucet every time he heard an explosion. Some idiot in Washington was actually going to list Project Hush in the military budget by name. It took fast action, I can tell you, to have it entered under Miscellaneous X Research. Well, we covered the unforgivable blunder, though not easily, and now we could get down to the real business of the project. You know, of course, about the A-bomb, H-bomb, and C-bomb, because information that they existed has been declassified. You don't know about the other weapons being devised, and neither did we, reasonably enough, since they weren't our business. But we had been given properly guarded notification that they were in the works. Project Hush was set up to counter the new weapons. Our goal was not just to reach the moon. We had done that on 24 June 1967 with an unmanned ship that carried instruments to report back data on soil, temperature, cosmic rays, and so on. Unfortunately, it was put out of commission by a rock slide. An unmanned rocket would be useless against the new weapons. We had to get to the moon before any other country did, and set up a permanent station, an armed one, and do it without anybody else knowing about it. I guess you can see now why we on, damn the name, Project Hush, were so concerned about security. But we felt pretty sure, before we took off, that we had plugged every possible leak. We had, all right.
nobody even knew we had raised ship. We landed at the northern tip of Mare Nubium, just off Regiomontanus, and after planting a flag with appropriate throat-catching ceremony, had swung into the realities of the tasks we had practiced on so many dry runs back on Earth. Major Monroe Gridley prepared the big rocket with its tiny cubicle of living space for the return journey to Earth, which he alone would make. Lieutenant Colonel Thomas Hawthorne painstakingly examined our provisions and portable quarters for any damage that might have been incurred in landing, and I, Colonel Benjamin Rice, first commanding officer of Army Base 1 on the Moon, dragged crate after enormous crate out of the ship on my aching academic back and piled them in the spot 200 feet away where the plastic dome would be built. We all finished at just about the same time as per schedule and went into Phase 2. Monroe and I started work on building the dome. It was a simple prefab affair, but big enough to require an awful lot of assembling. Then, after it was built, we faced the real problem, getting all the complex internal machinery in place and in operating order. Meanwhile, Tom Hawthorne took his plump self off in the single-seater rocket, which, up to then, had doubled as a lifeboat. The schedule called for him to make a rough 3-hour scouting survey in an ever-widening spiral from our dome. This had been regarded as a probable waste of time, rocket fuel, and manpower, but a necessary precaution. He was supposed to watch for such things as bug-eyed monsters out for a stroll on the lunar landscape. Basically, however, Tom's survey was intended to supply extra geological and astronomical meat for the report which Monroe was to carry back to Army HQ on Earth. Tom was back in 40 minutes, his round face inside its transparent bubble helmet was fish belly white. And so were ours once he told us what he'd seen. He had seen another dome. "The other side of Mare Nubium, in the Rapafin Mountains," he babbled excitedly. "It's a little bigger than ours and a little flatter on top, and not translucent either, with splotches of different colors here and there. It's a dull, dark, heavy gray, but that's all there is to see." "No markings on the dome?" I asked worriedly. "No signs of anyone or anything around it?" "Neither, Colonel." I noticed he was calling me by my rank for the first time since the trip started, which meant he was saying, in effect, "Man, have you got a decision to make?" "Hey, Tom," Monroe put in, "couldn't be just a regular shaped bump in the ground, could it? I'm a geologist, Monroe. I can distinguish artificial from natural topography. Besides," he looked up, "I just remembered something I left out. There's a brand new tiny crater near the dome, the kind usually left by a rocket exhaust." "Rocket exhaust?" I seized on that. "Rockets, eh?" Tom grinned a little sympathetically. "Spaceship exhaust, I should have said. You can't tell from the crater what kind of propulsive device these characters are using. It's not the same kind of crater our rear jets leave, if that helps any." Of course it didn't. So we went into our ship and had a council of war, and I do mean war. Both Tom and Monroe were calling me Colonel in every other sentence. I used their first names every chance I got. Still, no one but me could reach a decision. About what to do, I mean. "Look," I said at last, "here are the possibilities. They know we are here, either from watching us land a couple of hours ago, or from observing Tom's scout ship, or they do not know we are here. They are either humans from Earth, in which case they are in all probability enemy nationals, or they are alien creatures from another planet, in which case they may be friends, enemies, or what have you. I think common sense and standard military procedure demand that we consider them hostile until we have evidence to the contrary. Meanwhile, we proceed with extreme caution, so as not to precipitate an interplanetary war with potentially friendly Martians, or whatever they are.
All right. It's vitally important that Army headquarters be informed of this immediately. But since Earth-to-Moon radio is still on the drawing boards, the only way we can get through is to send Monroe back with the ship. If we do, we run the risk of having our garrison force, Tom and me, captured while he's making the return trip. In that case, their side winds up in possession of important information concerning our personnel and equipment, while our side is only the bare knowledge that somebody or something else has a base on the moon, so our primary need is more information. Therefore, I suggest that I sit in the dome on one end of a telephone hookup with Tom, who will sit in the ship, his hand over the firing button, ready to blast off for Earth the moment he gets the order from me. Monroe will take the single-seater down to the Ripayan Mountains, landing as close to the other dome as he thinks safe. He will then proceed the rest of the way on foot, doing the best scouting job he can in a spacesuit. He will not use his radio except for agreed-upon nonsense syllables to designate landing the single-seater, coming upon the dome by foot and warning me to tell Tom to take off. If he's captured, remembering that the first purpose of a scout is acquiring and transmitting knowledge of the enemy, he will snap his suit radio on full volume and pass on as much data as time and the enemy reflexes permit. How does that sound to you? They both nodded. As far as they were concerned, the command decision had been made. But I was sitting under 2 inches of sweat. "One question," Tom said. "Why did you pick Monroe for the scout?" "I was afraid you'd ask that," I told him. "We're three extremely unathletic PhDs who have been in the Army since we finished our schooling. There isn't too much choice. But I remember that Monroe is half Indian, Arapaho, isn't it, Monroe? And I'm hoping blood will tell." "Only trouble, Colonel," Monroe said slowly as he rose, "is that I'm 1/4 Indian. And even that, didn't I tell you that my great-grandfather was the only Arapaho scout who was with Custer at the Little Bighorn? He'd been positive Sitting Bull was miles away. However, I'll do my best. And if I heroically don't come back, would you please persuade the security office of our section to clear my name for use in the history books? Under the circumstances, I think it's the least he could do." I promised to do my best, of course. After he took off, I sat in the dome over the telephone connecting to Tom and hated myself for picking Monroe to do the job. But I'd have hated myself just as much for picking Tom. And if anything happened and I had to tell Tom to blast off, I'd probably be sitting here in the dome all by myself after that, waiting. "Brosnoggle," came over the radio in Monroe's resonant voice. He had landed the single-seater. I didn't dare use the telephone to chat with Tom in the ship, for fear I might miss an important word or phrase from our scout. So I sat and sat and strained my ears. After a while I heard, "Meshkashu," which told me that Monroe was in the neighborhood of the other dome and was creeping toward it under cover of whatever boulders were around. And then, abruptly, I heard Monroe yell my name, and there was a terrific clattering in my headphones. Radio interference. He'd been caught, and whoever had caught him had simultaneously jammed his suit transmitter with a large transmitter from the alien dome. After that, there was silence. After a while, I told Tom what had happened. He just said, "Poor Monroe." I had a good idea of what his expression was like. "Look, Tom," I said, "if you take off now, you still won't have anything important to tell. After capturing Monroe, whatever's in that other dome will come looking for us, I think. I let them get close enough for us to learn something of their appearance, at least if they're human or non-human. Any bit of information about them is important. I'll shout it up to you, and you'll still be able to take off in plenty of time. All right?" "You're the boss, Colonel," he said in a mournful voice. "Lots of luck."
and then there was nothing to do but wait. There was no oxygen system in the dome yet, so I had to squeeze up a sandwich from the food compartment in my suit. I sat there, thinking about the expedition. 9 years, and all that careful secrecy, all that expenditure of money and mind-cracking research, and it had all come to this, waiting to be wiped out in a blast from some unimaginable weapon. I understood Monroe's last request. We often felt we were so secret that our immediate supervisors didn't even want to know what we were working on. Scientists are people. They wish for recognition, too. I was hoping the whole expedition would be written up in the history books, but it looked unpromising. 2 hours later, the scout ship landed near the dome. The lock opened, and from where I stood in the open door of our dome, I saw Monroe come out and walk toward me. I alerted Tom and told him to listen carefully. It may be a trick. He might be drugged. He didn't act drugged, though, not exactly. He pushed his way past me and sat down on a box to one side of the dome. He put his booted feet up on another, smaller box. "How are you, Ben?" he asked. "How's every little thing?" I grunted. "Well?" I know my voice skittered a bit. He pretended puzzlement. "Well, what?" "Oh, I see what you mean. The other dome, you want to know who's in it." "You have a right to be curious, Ben, certainly. The leader of a top-secret expedition like this, Project Hush, they call us, huh, Ben, finds another dome on the moon. He thinks he's been the first to land on it, so naturally he wants to—" "Major Monroe Gridley," I rapped out, "you will come to attention and deliver your report now." Honestly, I felt my neck swelling up inside my helmet. Monroe just leaned back against the side of the dome. "That's the Army way of doing things," he commented admiringly. "Like the recruits say, there's a right way, a wrong way, and an Army way. Only there are other ways, too," he chuckled. "Lots of other ways." "He's off," I heard Tom whisper over the telephone. "Ben, Monroe has gone and blown his stack." "They aren't extraterrestrials in the other dome, Ben," Monroe volunteered in a sudden burst of sanity. "No, they're human, all right, and from Earth. Guess where?" "I'll kill you," I warned him. "I swear I'll kill you, Monroe. Where are they from? Russia? China? Argentina?" He grimaced. "What's so secret about those places? Go on, guess again." I stared at him long and hard. "The only place else." "Sure," he said. "You got it, Colonel. The other dome is owned and operated by the Navy. The goddamn United States Navy." End of Project Hush by William Tenn. Of All Possible Worlds by William Tenn. Story 3 of 3 science fiction stories by William Tenn. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. This story was first published in Galaxy Science Fiction, December 1956. Of All Possible Worlds. It was a good job, and Max Albin knew whom he had to thank for it, his great-grandfather. "Good old Giovanni Albani," he muttered as he hurried into the laboratory, slightly ahead of the escorting technicians, all of them, despite the excitement of the moment, remembering to bob their heads deferentially at the half-dozen full-fleshed and hard-faced men lolling on the couches that had been set up around the time machine. He shrugged rapidly out of his rags, as he had been instructed in the anteroom, and stepped into the housing of the enormous mechanism. This was the first time he had seen it since he had been taught how to operate it on a dummy model, and now he stared at the great transparent coils and the susurrating energy bubble with much respect. This machine, the pride and the hope of 2089, was something almost outside his powers of comprehension. But Max Albin knew how to run it, and he knew roughly what it was supposed to accomplish. He knew also that this was the first backward journey of any great duration and, being scientifically unpredictable, might well be the death of him. "Good old Giovanni Albani," he muttered again affectionately. If his great-grandfather had not volunteered for the earliest time-travel experiments way back in the 1970s, back even before the Blight, it would never have been discovered that he and his seed possessed a great deal of immunity to extratemporal blackout. And if that had not been discovered, the ruling powers of Earth, more than a century later, would never have plucked Max Albin out of an obscure civil service job as a relief guard at the North American Chicken Reservation to his present heroic and remunerative eminence. He would still be patrolling the barbed wire that surrounded the three white leghorn hens and two roosters, about 1/6 of the known livestock wealth of the Western Hemisphere, thoroughly content with a half pail of dried apricots he received each and every payday. No, if his great-grandfather had not demonstrated long ago his unique capacity for remaining conscious during time travel, Max Albin would not now be shifting from foot to foot in a physics laboratory, facing the black market kings of the world, and awaiting their final instructions with an uncertain and submissive grin. Men like O'Hara, who controlled mushrooms, Levney, the blackberry tycoon, Sargasso, the packaged worm monopolist, would black marketeers of their tremendous stature so much as waste a glance on someone like Albin ordinarily, let alone confer a lifetime pension on his wife and five children of a full spoonful each of non-synthetic sugar a day? Even if he didn't come back, his family was provided for like almost no other family on Earth. This was a damn good job, and he was lucky. Albin noticed that Abba Sadha had risen from the straight chair at the far side of the room and was approaching him with a sealed metal cylinder in one hand.
"We've decided to add a further precaution at the last moment," the old man said. "That is, the scientists have suggested it, and I have given my approval."
The last remark was added with a slight questioning note, as the Secretary-General of the United Nations looked back rapidly at the black market princes on the couches behind him. Since they stared back stonily but offered no objection, he coughed in relief and returned to Albin.
"I am sure, young man, that I don't have to go into the details of your instructions once more. You enter the time machine and go back the duration for which it has been preset, 113 years, to the moment after the guided missile of 1976 was launched. It is 1976, isn't it?" he asked, suddenly uncertain.
"Yes, sir," one of the technicians standing by the time machine said respectfully. "The experiment with an atomic warhead guided missile that resulted in the Blight was conducted on this site on April 18, 1976. He glanced proudly at the unemotional men on the couches, very much like a small boy after completing a recitation before visiting dignitaries from the Board of Education.
"Just so," Abd Sadha nodded. "April 18, 1976. And on this site. You see, young man, you will materialize at the very moment and on the very spot where the remote control station handling the missile was, handling the missile. You will be in a superb position, to deflect the missile in its downward course and alter human history for the better. Very much for the better, yes."
He paused, having evidently stumbled out of his thought sequence.
"And he pulls the red switch toward him,"
Gomez, the dandelion root magnate, reminded him sharply, impatiently. "Ah, yes, the red switch. He pulls the little red switch toward him. Thank you, Mr. Gomez. Thank you very much, sir."
He pulls the little red switch on the green instrument panel toward him, thus preventing the error that caused the missile to explode in the Brazilian jungle and causing it instead to explode somewhere in the mid-Pacific, as originally planned. The Secretary General of the United Nations beamed, thus preventing the blight, making it non-existent, as it were, producing a present-day world in which the blight never occurred. That is correct, is it not, gentlemen? He asked, turning anxiously again. None of the half-dozen men on couches deigned to answer him, and Albin kept his eyes deferentially in their direction, too, as he had throughout this period of last-minute instruction. He knew who ruled his world. The stolid, well-fed men in clean garments, with a minimum of patches, and where patches occurred, at least they were the color of the surrounding cloth. Sata might be Secretary General of the United Nations, but that was still a civil service job, only a few social notches higher than a chicken guard. His clothes were fully as ragged, fully as multicolored, as those that Albin had stepped out of, and the gnawing in his stomach was no doubt almost as great. "You understand, do you not, young man, that if anything goes wrong?" Abd Sadha asked, his head nodding tremulously and anticipating the answer. "If anything unexpected, unprepared for, occurs, you are not to continue with the experiment but return immediately?"
"He understands everything he has to understand," Gomez told him. "Let's get this thing moving."
The old man smiled again. "Yes, of course, Mr. Gomez." He came up to where Albin stood in the entrance of the time machine and handed the sealed metal cylinder to him. "This is the precaution the scientists have added. When you arrive at your destination, just before materializing, you will release it into the surrounding temporal medium. Our purpose here, as you no doubt..."
Levny sat up on his couch and snapped his fingers peremptorily. "I just heard Gomez tell you to get this thing moving, Sadha. And it isn't moving. We're busy men. We've wasted enough time."
"I was just trying to explain a crucial final fact," the Secretary General apologized. "A fact which may be highly..."
"You've explained enough facts." Levny turned to the man inside the time machine. "Hey, fella, you, move."
Max Albin gulped and nodded violently. He darted to the rear of the machine and turned the dial which activated it.
Flick!
It was a good job, and Mac Albin knew whom he had to thank for it, his great-grandfather.
"Good old Giovanni Albani," he laughed as he looked at the morose faces of his two colleagues.
Bob Skiat and Hugo Honeck had done as much as he to build the tiny time machine in the secret lab under the helicopter garage, and they were fully as eager to go, but, unfortunately for them, they were not descended from the right ancestor. Leisurely, he unzipped the richly embroidered garment that, as the father of two children, he was privileged to wear, and wriggled into the housing of the complex little mechanism. This was hardly the first time he had seen it, since he'd been helping to build the device from the moment Honeck had nodded and risen from the drafting board, and now he barely wasted a glance on the thumb-sized, translucent coils growing out of the almost microscopic energy bubbles which powered them. This machine was the last hope of 2089, even if the world of 2089 as a whole did not know of its existence and would try to prevent its being put into operation. But it meant a lot more to Mac Albin than merely saving a world. It meant an adventurous mission with the risk of death.
"Good old Giovanni Albani," he laughed happily.
If his great-grandfather had not volunteered for the earliest time-travel experiments way back in the 1970s, even before the epidemic, it would never have been discovered that he and his seed possessed a great deal of immunity to extratemporal blackout.
and if that had not been discovered, the Albans would not have become physicists upon the passage of the United Nations law that everyone on Earth, absolutely without exception, had to choose a branch of research science in which to specialize. In the flabby, careful, life-guarding world the Earth had become, Mac Albin would never have been reluctantly selected by his two co-workers as the one to carry the forbidden banner of dangerous experiment. No, if his great-grandfather had not demonstrated long ago his unique capacity for remaining conscious during time travel, Mac Albin would probably be a biologist today, like almost everyone else on Earth, laboriously working out dreary gene problems instead of embarking on the greatest adventure man had known to date. Even if he didn't come back, he had at last found a socially useful escape from genetic responsibility to humanity in general, and his own family in particular. This was a damn good job, and he was lucky.
"Wait a minute, Mac," Skiat said, and crossed to the other side of the narrow laboratory.
Albin and Honeck watched him stuff several sheets of paper into a small metal box which he closed without locking.
"You will take care of yourself, won't you, Mac?" Hugo Honeck pleaded.
"Any time you feel like taking an unnecessary risk, remember that Bob and I will have to stand trial if you don't come back. We might be sentenced to complete loss of professional status and spend the rest of our lives supervising robot factories."
"Oh, it won't be that bad," Albin reassured him absent-mindedly from where he lay contorted inside the time machine.
He watched Skiat coming toward him with the box.
Honeck shrugged his shoulders. "It might be a lot worse than even that, and you know it. The disappearance of a two-time father is going to leave an awful big vacancy in the world. One-timers like Bob and me are all over the place. If either of us dropped out of sight, it wouldn't cause nearly as much uproar."
"But Bob and you both tried to operate the machine," Albin reminded him, "and you blacked out after a 15-second temporal displacement. So I'm the only chance, the only way, to stop the human race from dwindling and dwindling till it hits absolute zero, like that fat old Security Council seems willing for it to do."
"Take it easy, Mac," Bob Skiat said as he handed the metal box to Albin.
"The Security Council is just trying to solve the problem in their way, the conservative way. A worldwide concentration on genetics research coupled with the maximum preservation of existing human lives, especially those that have a high reproductive potential. We three disagree with them. We've been skulking down here nights to solve it our way, and ours is a radical approach and plenty risky. That's the reason for the metal box, trying to cover one more explosive possibility."
Albin turned it around curiously.
"How?"
"I sat up all night writing the manuscript that's inside it. Look, Mac, when you go back to the guided missile experiment of 1976 and push that red switch away from you, a lot of other things are going to happen than just deflecting the missile so that it will explode in the Brazilian jungle instead of the Pacific Ocean."
"Sure, I know. If it explodes in the jungle, the epidemic doesn't occur. No Shapiro's mumps."
Skiat jiggled his pudgy little face impatiently. "That's not what I mean. The epidemic doesn't occur, but something else does. A new world, a different 2089, an alternate time sequence. It'll be a world in which humanity has a better chance to survive, but it'll be one with problems of its own. Maybe tough problems. Maybe the problems will be tough enough so that they'll get the same idea we did and try to go back to the same point in time to change them."
Albin laughed. "That's just looking for trouble."
"Maybe it is, but that's my job. Hugo's the designer of the time machine and you're the operator, but I'm the theoretical man in this research team. It's my job to look for trouble, so just in case I wrote a brief history of the world from the time the missile exploded in the Pacific. It tells why ours is the worst possible of futures. It's in that box.
What do I do with it?
Hand it to the guy from the alternate 2089? The small, fat man exasperatedly hit the side of the time machine with a well-cushioned palm.
You know better. There won't be any alternate 2089 until you push that red switch on the green instrument panel. The moment you do, our world, with all its slow slide to extinction, goes out, and its alternate goes on, just like two electric light bulbs on a push-pull circuit. We, and every single one of our artifacts, including the time machine, disappear. The problem is how to keep that manuscript from disappearing. Well, all you do, if I have this figured right, is shove the metal box containing the manuscript out into the surrounding temporal medium a moment before you materialize to do your job. That temporal medium in which you'll be traveling is something that exists independent of and autonomous to all possible futures. It's my hunch that something that's immersed in it will not be altered by a new time sequence.
Remind him to be careful, Bob, Harnack rumbled. He thinks he's Captain Blood, and this is his big chance to run away to sea and become a swashbuckling pirate.
Albin grimaced in annoyance. I am excited by doing something besides sitting in a safe little corner working out safe little abstractions for the first time in my life. But I know that this is a first experiment. Honestly, Hugo, I really have enough intelligence to recognize that simple fact. I know that if anything unexpected pops up, anything we didn't foresee, I'm supposed to come scuttling back and ask for advice.
I hope you do, Bob Skiat sighed. I hope you do know that. A 20th century poet once wrote something to the effect that the world will end not with a bang, but a whimper. Well, our world is ending with a whimper. Try to see that it doesn't end with a bang, either.
That I'll promise you, Albin said a trifle disgustedly. It'll end with neither a bang nor a whimper.
So long, Hugo. So long, Bob.
He twisted around, reaching overhead for the lever which activated the forces that drove the time machine. Flick!
It was strange, Max Albin reflected, that this time travel business, which knocked unconscious everyone who tried it, only made him feel slightly dizzy. That was because he was descended from Giovanni Albani, he had been told. There must be some complicated scientific explanation for it, he decided, and that would make it none of his business. Better forget about it. All around the time machine there was a heavy gray murk in which objects were hinted at rather than stated definitely. It reminded him of patrolling his beat at the North American Chicken Reservation in a thick fog. According to his gauges, he was now in 1976. He cut speed until he hit the last day of April, then cut speed again, drifting slowly backward to the 18th, the day of the infamous guided missile experiment. Carefully, carefully, like a man handling a strange bomb made on a strange planet, he watched the center gauge until the needle came to rest against the thin etched line that indicated the exact crucial moment. Then he pulled the brake and stopped the machine dead. All he had to do now was materialize in the right spot, flash out and pull the red switch toward him, then his well-paid assignment would be done. But he stopped and scratched his dirt-matted hair. Wasn't there something he was supposed to do a second before materialization? Yes, that useless old windbag, Sadha had given him a last instruction. He picked up the sealed metal cylinder, walked to the entrance of the time machine, and tossed it into the gray murk. A solid object floating near the entrance caught his eye. He put his arm out, whew, it was cold, and pulled it inside. A small metal box. Funny. What was it doing out there? Curiously, he opened it, hoping to find something valuable. Nothing but a few sheets of paper, Albin noticed disappointedly. He began to read them slowly, very slowly, for the manuscript was full of a lot of long and complicated words, like a letter from one bookworm scientist to another. The problem all began with the guided missile experiment of 1976, he read. There had been a number of such experiments, but it was the one of 1976 that finally did the damage the biologist had been warning about. The missile with its deadly warhead exploded in the Pacific Ocean as planned. The physicist and the military men went home to study their notes, and the world shivered once more over the approaching war and tried to forget about it. But there was fallout, a radioactive rain several hundred miles to the north, and a small fishing fleet got thoroughly soaked by it. Fortunately, the radioactivity in the rain was sufficiently low to do little obvious physical damage. All it did was cause a mutation in the mumps virus that several of the men in the fleet were incubating at the time, having caught it from the children of the fishing town, among whom a minor epidemic was raging. The fleet returned to its hometown, which promptly came down with the new kind of mumps. Dr. Llewellyn Shapiro, the only physician in town, was the first man to note that, while the symptoms of this disease were substantially milder than those of its unmutated parent, practically no one was immune to it, and its effects on human reproductivity were truly terrible. Most people were completely sterilized by it. The rest were rendered much less capable of fathering or bearing offspring. Shapiro's mumps spread over the entire planet in the next few decades. It leaped across every quarantine erected. For a long time it successfully defied all the vaccines and serums attempted against it. Then, when a vaccine was finally perfected, humanity discovered to its dismay that its generative powers had been permanently and fundamentally impaired. Something had happened to the germ plasm. A large percentage of individuals were born sterile, and of those who were not, one child was usually the most that could be expected, a two-child parent being quite rare, and a three-child parent almost unknown. Strict eugenic control was instituted by the Security Council of the United Nations so that fertile men and women would not be wasted upon non-fertile mates. Fertility was the most important avenue to social status, and right after it came successful genetic research. Genetic research had the very best minds prodded into it. The lesser ones went into the other sciences. Everyone on Earth was engaged in some form of scientific research to some extent. Since the population was now so limited in proportion to the great resources available, all physical labor had long been done by robots. The government saw to it that everybody had an ample supply of goods and, in return, asked only that they experiment without any risk to their own lives. Every human being was now a much prized, highly guarded rarity. There were less than 100,000 of them, well below the danger point it had been estimated, where a species might be wiped out by a new calamity. Not that another calamity would be needed. Since the end of the epidemic, the birth rate had been moving further and further behind the death rate. In another century, that was why a desperate and secret attempt to alter the past was being made. This kind of world was evidently impossible. Max Albin finished the manuscript and sighed. What a wonderful world! What a comfortable place to live! He walked to the rear dials and began the process of materializing at the crucial moment of April 18, 1976. Flick. It was odd, Max Albin reflected, that these temporal journeys, which induced coma in everyone who tried it, only made him feel slightly dizzy. That was because he was descended from Giovanni Albani, he knew. Maybe there was some genetic relationship with his above-average fertility. Might be a good idea to mention the idea to a biologist or two when he returned, if he returned. All around the time machine there was a soupy gray murk in which objects were hinted at rather than stated definitely. It reminded him of the problems of landing a helicopter in a thick fog when the robot butler had not been told to turn on the ground lights. According to the insulated register, he was now in 1976. He lowered speed until he registered April, then maneuvered slowly backward through time to the 18th, the day of the infamous guided missile experiment. Carefully, carefully, like an obstetrician supervising surgical robots at an unusually difficult birth, he watched the register until it rolled to rest against the notch that indicated the exact crucial moment. Then he pushed a button and froze the machine where it was. All he had to do now was materialize in the right spot, flash out, and push the red switch from him. Then his exciting adventure would be over. But he paused and tapped at his sleek chin. He was supposed to do something a second before materialization. Yes, that nervous theoretician Bob Skiat had given him a last suggestion. He picked up the small metal box, twisted around to face the opening of the time machine, and dropped it into the gray murk. A solid object floating near the opening attracted his attention. He shot his arm out. It was cold as they had figured, and pulled the object inside. A sealed metal cylinder. Strange. What was it doing out there? Anxiously he opened it, not daring to believe he'd find a document inside. Yes, that was exactly what it was, he saw excitedly. He began to read it rapidly, very rapidly, as if it were a newly published paper on neutrinos. Besides, the manuscript was written with almost painful simplicity, like a textbook composed by a stuffy pedagogue for the use of morons. The problem all began with the guided missile experiment of 1976, he read. There had been a number of such experiments, but it was the one of 1976 that finally did the damage the biologist had been warning about. The missile, with its deadly warhead, exploded in the Brazilian jungle through some absolutely unforgivable error in the remote control station. The officer in charge of the station was reprimanded and the men under him court-martialed, and the Brazilian government was paid a handsome compensation for the damage. But there had been more damage than anyone knew at the time. A plant virus, similar to the tobacco mosaic, had mutated under the impact of radioactivity. 5 years later, it burst out of the jungle and completely wiped out every last rice plant on Earth. Japan and a large part of Asia became semi-deserts inhabited by a few struggling nomads. Then the virus adjusted to wheat and corn, and famine howled in every street of the planet. All attempts by botanists to control the blight failed because of the swiftness of its onslaught. And after it had fed, it hit again at a new plant, and another. Most of the world's non-human mammals had been slaughtered for food long before they could starve to death. Many insects, too, before they became extinct at the loss of their edible plants, served to assuage hunger to some small extent. But the nutritive potential of Earth was steadily diminishing in a horrifying geometric progression. Recently, it had been observed, plankton, the tiny organism on which most of the sea's ecology was based, had started to disappear, and with its diminution, dead fish had begun to pile up on the beaches. Mankind had lunged out desperately in all directions in an effort to survive, but nothing had worked for any length of time. Even the other planets of the solar system, which had been reached and explored at a tremendous cost in remaining resources, had yielded no edible vegetation. Synthetics had failed to fill the prodigious gap. In the midst of the sharply increasing hunger, social controls had pretty much dissolved. Pathetic attempts at rationing still continued, but black markets became the only markets, and black marketeers the barons of life. Starvation took the hindmost, and only the most agile economically lived in comparative comfort. Law and order were had only by those who could afford to pay for them, and children of impoverished families were sold on the open market for a bit of food. But the blight was still adjusting to new plants, and the food supply kept shrinking. In another century, that was why the planet's powerful individuals had been persuaded to pool their wealth in a desperate attempt to alter the past. This kind of world was manifestly impossible. MacAlban finished the document and sighed. What a magnificent world! What an exciting place to live! He dropped his hand on the side levers and began the process of materializing at the crucial moment of April 18, 1976. Flick. As the equipment of the remote control station began to take on a blurred reality all around him, MacAlban felt a bit of fear at what he was doing. The technicians, he remembered, the Secretary General, even the Black Market Kings, had all warned him not to go ahead with his instructions if anything unusual turned up. That was an awful lot of power to disobey. He knew he should return with this new information and let better minds work on it. They, with their easy lives, what did they know what existence had been like for such as he? Hunger, always hunger, scrabbling, servility, and more hunger. Every time things got really tight, you and your wife looked sideways at your kids and wondered which of them would bring the best price, buying security for them as he was now at the risk of his life. But in this other world, this other 2089, there was a state that took care of you and that treasured your children. A man like himself, with five children, why, he'd be a big man, maybe the biggest man on Earth. And he'd have robots to work for him and lots of food. Above all, lots and lots of food. He'd even be a scientist. Everyone was a scientist there, weren't they? And he'd have a big laboratory all to himself. This other world had its troubles. But it was a lot nicer place than where he'd come from. He couldn't return. He'd go through with it. The fear left him, and for the first time in his life, MacAlban felt the sensation of power. He materialized the time machine around the green instrument panel, sweating a bit at the sight of the room full of military figures, despite the technician's reassurances that all this would be happening too fast to be visible. He saw the single red switch pointing upward on the instrument panel, the switch that controlled the course of the missile. Now to make a halfway decent world! MacAlban pulled the little red switch toward him. Flick. As the equipment of the remote control station began to oscillate into reality all around him, MacAlban felt a bit of shame at what he was doing. He'd promised Bob and Hugo to drop the experiment at any stage if a new factor showed up. He knew he should go back with this new information and have all three of them kick it around. But what would they be able to tell him, they with their blissful adjustment to their thoroughly blueprinted lives? They at least had been ordered to marry women they could live with. He'd drawn a female with whom he was completely incompatible in any but a genetic sense. Genetics! He was tired of genetics and the sanctity of human life. Tired to the tip of his uncalloused fingers. Tired to the recesses of his unused muscles. He was tired of having to undertake a simple adventure like a thief in the night. But in this other world, this other 2089... someone like himself would be a monarch of the black market, a suzerain of chaos, making his own rules, taking his own women. So what if the weaklings, those unfit to carry on the race, went to the wall? His kind wouldn't. He'd formed a pretty good idea of the kind of men who ruled that other world from the document in the sealed metal cylinder. The black marketeers had not even read it. Why, the fools had obviously been duped by the technicians into permitting the experiment. They had not grasped the idea that an alternate time track would mean their own non-existence. This other world had its troubles, but it was certainly a livelier place than where he'd come from. It deserved a chance. Yes, that was how he felt. His world was drowsily moribund. This alternate was starving, but managing to flail away at destiny. It deserved a chance. Alban decided that he was experiencing renunciation and felt proud. He materialized the time machine around the green instrument panel, disregarding the room full of military figures since he knew they could not see him. The single red switch pointed downward on the instrument panel. That was the gimmick that controlled the course of the missile. Now to make a halfway interesting world. Mac Alban pushed the little red switch from him. Flick. Now to make a halfway decent world. Mac Alban pulled the little red switch toward him. Flick. Now to make a halfway interesting world. Mac Alban pushed the little red switch from him. Flick. Pulled the little red switch toward him. Flick. Pushed the little red switch from him. Flick. Toward him. Flick. From him. Flick. End of All Possible Worlds by William Tenn. End of Three Science Fiction Stories by William Tenn. These stories recorded by Phil Chenevert, September of 2019, in Baton Rouge, Louisiana.